Hey folks, welcome back to another Dice Tower Preview. I'm Mark, and today we're taking a look at Dead Man's Chess, which is brought to you by Spyglass Games. It's for 2-4 players, ages 14 and up, and games generally run about 30 to 60 minutes. In this battlefield strategy game, you will battle individually or as teams. You will bring the full might of your unique faction to bear against your opponents, using chess-like moves to crush your enemies. Victory goes to the greatest force remaining when the battle draws to a close. Each faction wields their own boost upgrades, epic axe, and special powers to offer unique playstyle and edge in the coming battle. Destroy your opponents, bolster your forces, and declare victory for your glory when the melee draws to a close. Strategy is not enough. Luck is not enough. You will need both to win. Throw out any preconceptions you know about classic chess, because new moves, accelerated gameplay, and the ability to defend against incoming attacks on each and every combat is what sets Dead Man's Chess far apart from its predecessor. Your goal is a simple one. Come out on top, scoring the highest victory point value from your remaining pieces at the end of 9 rounds. So, the game is going to offer many ways to play. You can do your simple one-on-one, or you can do teams, or you can do a full-on battle royale with 4 players. I chose a 3-player setup because it's fairly unique, how you put the pieces out, and all the pieces do relate back to chess pieces, but that's really where the similarity ends, because each turn is going to be varied and different, and you have different powers and cards and abilities and dice, all kinds of things that are going to come into play as you battle across this field. I chose also the pirate board because I like the crew. I played with the crew a couple times now, and I really like their abilities and such, but there are so many different factions to choose from. Just tons of different ones they're gonna have available that you can purchase for this game. And there's gonna be tons of different game boards, all very clearly labeled about how you set up the different versions of the game, and all nicely lined, and also icons on the board showing you where you put your pieces. So quick and easy setup. So this version that I'm filming with today is their beautiful painted version that they take to conventions and graciously let me film with for this video. But the base game that you're going to get is going to be unpainted. But the thing to note though is that all the different pieces, even they look very unique and have very different types of creatures or pirates, whatever it is, you'll see that their bases clearly mark what type of piece they are. If they're a pawn, if they're a king, they're a queen, whatever it is, it's all on the base of the figures. So to start off, obviously you'll choose your faction. You'll be placing it out on the player board, and each player does have a faction board that you'll be playing from. Now, there's card slots here, which we'll get to, but everything you really need to know to play the game is here. You could really step through it and learn it pretty quickly. So if you know chess, basic chess moves, then it's gonna be very straightforward to jump into this. Now, the thing is that this player board has so many different points of interest. You've got the guide showing you what your attack and defense values are, as well as the victory points that each of the different pieces are worth at the end of the game. The last one standing, that is, at the end of 9 rounds. And then you've got your progression of play on the board, as well as your faction's special ability and your faction's title at the top. So we'll go through the progression of a turn, but this board is just key, and all the factions have so many different powers and abilities and cards that you can play. There are 3 different decks of cards that you'll be tapping into through the course of the game, 2 of which are specific to your faction. But first we have the battlefield deck, which also acts as the timer, the round tracker. You're going to be shuffling this up and dealing 9 to each player, placing them face down on your player board. Now, you'll be drawing them and you'll be using them to move pieces around the board. And then you have the boost deck. And the boost deck is fantastic because what it does is it allows you to augment one of your pieces that are in battle currently. So you'll be able to add a base to them and then attach the card to it to give it some sort of special ability. And then you have the epic act cards, which these cards are gonna be a little bit difficult to get because obviously they are huge game changers. And you'll be using them obviously to sway the tides of battle through the course of the game. So there's gonna be 3 phases to your turn. First you have the boost phase, then you have the battlefield phase, and finally the promotion phase. Now the boost phase, the first thing you're doing is you're rolling your dice, and you're gonna be looking at your player sheet, and you have specific faction abilities that you can possibly tap into, but you have to make a choice. You can either use your special ability, you can get a boost card, or you can get an epic card. Now, there are requirements here, obviously. Some of the different faction abilities are going to require a dice value, and to get a boost card, you need to roll a 6 or better, and we'll talk about how you can get better. And then for an epic card, you need an 8 or better. So for every 2 pieces that have been captured of yours, you get a +1. So that's how you add those values to your dice. So it's the very first thing you're doing at the start of your turn, rolling that dice and then making a choice about using your abilities or grabbing one of those 2 cards if you have the appropriate dice value. So all those factions' abilities are going to be wide and varied and require very different dice rolls depending on which one you're playing. So if you chose to use your different faction's ability, that's all you're doing in the boost phase. If you got a boost card, then you'll grab a base and attach the card to the appropriate piece, giving it augmented abilities to battle with. And finally, if you did get one of those epic act cards, you don't have to play it right away. You can hold on to it, save it. You can basically play it anytime you want. These cards are super powerful, again, game changers. Then we have the battlefield phase, which is the meat of the game, where you'll be moving your chess pieces, trying to capture others, go to battle, and so forth. So the thing here is that you're going to be using your battlefield cards. You have to play one, and you also just get one basic move, which is just a standard chess move like you do in any chess game. And so you get both those, and you can play them in any order you want. You can do the standard move first or play your card. The cards, though, are going to do all kinds of different things, like this one, the escort. You can move a knight and or pawn, so you can do both. So it might be strategic value to move them first and then move your other piece. Now, one of the things about chess, obviously, you take your finger off it, you can't do anything about it. In this game, if you haven't moved another piece, then you can always take back the piece that you just played. So as you move around the battlefield, you're going to be entering into combat quite frequently. You are trying to remove your opponent from the battlefield after all. Now there's no concept of check or checkmate in this version of quote unquote chess, but the thing is that your king is worth a ton of victory points if it's still standing at the end of 9 rounds. So you do want to try to keep your king safe, but it's also a very powerful piece. So it's a real trade-off how you use it. But you do have a couple different types of attacks, especially if you've got boost cards. You might have ranged attacks that do some very crazy things in the game. But let's just take a look at the basics. You're just gonna move a chess piece like you normally would to take someone else's piece and remove it from the board. So it is not just that simple though. It's not like chess. Both of you are going to roll a pair of dice. You'll take that value and add it to your defense value, or you'll add it to your attack value. And whoever has the highest value wins. Now, there's one condition here. If you're the attacker and you win, your opponent still has one last ditch effort to just save themselves. They're gonna roll a 6-sided dice. If they hit a 6, then they block your attack successfully. However, the defender, if they roll and end up on top in that initial battle, then they have the ability to take your piece as the attacker. So battles are fraught with danger. You as the attacker don't always have the advantage, except attack values do have a higher chance of hitting because they are more aggressive, so to say. But defense can have its benefits. I mean, you can take pieces that way, which is really nice. So there's a lot of back and forth in those battles. And again, the boost cards and all the different augments you can do to the dice rolls and things really do add a lot of flavor to the game. And it does feel like this battle royale, battle chess, back and forth. Really, really fun. Now, the final phase of the round, or for your turn, is the fact that you can promote. Now, if you've moved one of your pawns across the board to an enemy's stronghold, then you can promote that piece to a bigger, better piece. Well, except for the king, you can't do that, but you could bring your queen back. So lots of different options as you get to the end of the battlefield with one of your pawns. So I really like that. And pawns in general are gonna have some variation too based on player count, how they move and so forth. But they can attack diagonal, things like that. Some really fun things that the pawns can augment and add to the game. Again, those boost cards are really the thing though. Adding those to pieces just opens them up for doing all kinds of fun aspects for sure. So that's really the basics of what you're doing. You really should have a handle on how chess pieces move to understand how to play this a little bit better. But at the end of 9 rounds, whoever has the most point value, victory points, in pieces that are still standing is going to be the ultimate champion of Dead Man's Chess. All right, folks, just a reminder once again, this has been a Dice Tower paid preview, and everything you've seen here has been in prototype form. So keep a close eye on the campaign for any changes that still may occur. Now, with that said, you know, all the different factions is what really adds the flavor to this game. All their abilities and their different cards, just are super thematic to that faction. They've done a great job with that because it does add that flavor, and that sense of rush into battle is totally in this game. And you never know what's gonna happen in a battle with those dice rolls and so forth. So you are heavily relying on dice rolls, but you do have ways to augment that as well. So lots of back and forth and pieces flying off the board and coming back, things like that. And based on the different abilities of the factions too, like the undead who can reanimate their different pieces. So you have to be on guard at all times. But folks, ultimately, if this was like something of interest to you, I'm sure they'd appreciate your support. So I think that's it for me, and until next time, we'll see you at the table.